Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents How to Innovate, an Ancient Guide to Creative Thinking, by Aristotle. Translated with commentary by Armand D'Angour. Read by Shaun, Grindell. Thinking New Thoughts Every Day. Democritus, Philosopher, 5th century BCE. Preface. It used to be said that the ancient Greeks were not keen on innovation. That view was based on a partial and insufficiently discerning interpretation of the evidence of ancient writings, and historians now recognize that the Greeks were never as disinclined to innovate as had been assumed. In fact, what requires explanation is the conspicuously innovative achievement that has always been recognized as a feature of ancient Greek society. Certain conditions, fertile for innovation, must have allowed for the range of inventions and discoveries that makes ancient Greek culture so influential for its inheritors in subsequent generations. In addition to these conditions, various mechanisms can be seen to underlie their innovative practices. Mechanisms such as the borrowing and adaptation of external ideas, the cross-fertilizing of disparate disciplines, and the posing of disruptive critiques to the ideas and practices of their predecessors. These principles of innovation were not systematically formulated by the Greeks themselves. They emerged from various writings that addressed the notion of innovation in different ways. The format of this book, therefore, while taking a single and overridingly influential author, Aristotle, to provide the central texts, adduces other less well-known ancient sources to illustrate innovations that represent the key mechanisms of the Greeks' innovative practices. Note on the texts. For ease of matching translation to the original, I have divided up the texts of Aristotle and Athenaeus into shorter paragraphs, and provided a new alphabetical numeration for each section. The numbering and structure of the texts of Diodorus is that of the standard scholarly editions. I have aimed to create translations that are both accurate and manageable, using the Greek texts, with a few minor variants, of the Loeb Classical Library editions. Introduction. Innovation is the driving force of the modern world. In technology, politics, business, art, music, academia, the military, and countless other areas of life, change is constant, and the search for novelty is unremitting. Responses to change range from excitement to fear. Change means loss, and when things are changing fast, there can be little time to digest what has been lost and to embrace the new. While some may feel a pressure to be innovative, others are perplexed about the meaning of innovation and the value of the new. What is innovation, and how is one to think about creating change? Athens in the archaic and classical period, around 800 to 300 BCE, was a fast-changing society in which the idea of innovation was, for the first time in the written record, explicitly raised and discussed. The earliest use of a word for forging something new, Greek kainotomia, is found in a comic play by the dramatist Aristophanes, dating from the late 5th century BCE. While it's often said that the ancient Greeks were averse to novelty and reluctant to innovate, their writings show that in a range of disciplines, they were well aware of the power and advantages of the new. I don't sing the old songs, my new songs are better, run the lines of some lyrics composed by the singer-songwriter Timotheus of Miletus in the late 5th century BCE. A similar promotion of novelty can be found in many other fields of activity and intellectual pursuits of the period. Despite largely conducting their lives within the bounds of a traditional agrarian society, the classical Greeks were responsible for creating a series of world-changing innovations. Early in the period of their efflorescence, they invented the alphabet by borrowing and adapting letter forms used in the Near Eastern nation of Phoenicia, and the Greek alphabet, as further adapted by the Romans, has been central to communication ever since. They went on to invent philosophy, logic, rhetoric, and mathematical proof, to be the first practitioners of theatrical drama, rational medicine, monetary coinage and lifelike sculpture, and to create competitive athletics, architectural canons, the self-governing city-state, polis, and democratic politics. These transformative cultural changes, which took place over the five centuries from 800 to 300 BCE, cannot have happened by accident. None of the Greeks' creations, nor the products thereof, some of which have never been surpassed, could have come into being without the contributions of individuals who created and operated in conditions fertile for change, who were prepared and keen to innovate, and who understood how to exploit the means of doing so. Some Greeks also sought to understand the conditions that made innovation possible, and descriptions of the creative procedures that led to many of the Greeks' novel achievements are preserved in their writings. What surviving texts illustrate is that, while the processes of creativity are potentially endless, the creation of the new relies on a few basic principles, notably the adaptation of existing elements, the cross-fertilization of disparate entities, and the disruption of previous conditions. On these principles and combinations of them, change was created in practice for centuries. It inspired the earliest Greek thinkers from the 6th century BCE to ask questions such as, where does everything come from? And what is change? Toward the end of the classical period, Aristotle, 384 to 322 BCE, sought to analyze the logic of change on different levels, natural, metaphysical, and political. Aristotle's theoretical analysis of change in Physics Book 1 begins by refuting the counterintuitive notion proposed by predecessors such as Parmenides that change itself is impossible. He goes on to argue that all change requires a pre-existing situation or substrate from which change can and must proceed. His argument may be generalized to affirm that the new depends on the old, a position summarized in Physics Book 1. Aristotle was keen to understand change in practice as well as in theory. The key political unit of the Greek world of his time was the polis, independent citizen-run state. Around 1,000 existed in the classical period. How the polis might best be organized is the focus of the philosopher's discussion in his Politics Book 2. There, Aristotle discusses and critiques the governments of some existing states and considers blueprints for new kinds of government, such as those proposed by Socrates in Plato's Republic and Plato in his Laws, as well as examining the innovative constitutional proposals of less well-known political theorists. The novelty in thought and action generated by the Greek city-states of classical times laid the basis for the artistic, intellectual, and scientific discoveries, some 2 millennia later, of the European Renaissance. Writers and artists in that period of rebirth supposed that they were engaged in a recreation of Greek ideas in science, art, music, and many other fields. A large part of the education offered in Renaissance universities involved the interpretation of Aristotle's works and the study of his ancient commentators. It made sense for thinkers then, and it still makes sense today, to look to the great philosopher of antiquity to deepen our understanding about, among other things, the principles of change. The two longest texts chosen for this book, taken from Aristotle's Physics 1 and Politics 2, to accompany the first and last chapters, respectively present the philosopher's closely argued theoretical analysis.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.